So there's a general understanding and agreement that polarization in American politics today is a problem, and that it seems incompatible with our constitutional aspirations for the way our government should operate. But if it was the case that the polarization simply reflects the views of the American people, then that would at least give us some comfort that what's happening in politics is the result of what the political system and the democracy at this particular moment call for. But it turns out not to be true, that the American public, in fact, is not all that polarized relative to the past. In fact, political scientists tell us that at the present time, between 40 and 45% of American voters are more or less moderate, and that's fairly standard for much of American history. So to the extent we perceive a greater polarization today, it's not really a polarization that's reflected in the electorate, and that should give us pause. And in fact, if you look to see what polarization means, you can see very easily in how the Congress is now constituted. Again, political scientists tell us that in 1970, 47% of the members of the United States Senate were regarded as moderate. And today that percentage is 5%. And it's even worse in the House of Representatives. And what that suggests is a kind of dysfunction, that there's a dramatic gap between the views and attitudes of the American people and the commonality and differences that exist among our citizens, and what we wind up with in our elected representatives. And to that extent, if we are polarized in our politics, that suggests that something is going wrong to produce that. So Heather looked at one possible culprit, which is the gerrymandering process in which the line drawing of districts has been done in a way to preserve safe seats, which is likely to enable more extreme candidates to get elected than if you had more competitive districts. And as rightly noted, the fact that the empirical data that is the cause of the polarization is still not well established. Another possible culprit is the primary system, ironically. And part of the theme of this panel is unintended consequences, and in this instance, the primary system, to the extent it is a culprit, certainly is an example of unintended consequences. So party primaries really came into existence in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, primarily as a reaction to the backroom deals of party hacks, who essentially selected candidates without any input or interest on the part of the people, who were then simply given the opportunity of choosing between two individuals who'd been selected for them by individuals in the smoke-filled rooms. And progressives in particular thought that was not a very a good way to run a democracy, and therefore devised the idea of the primary as a way of selecting candidates and taking it out of the control of the political elite. And for a long time, party primaries were thought to be a highly democratizing institution that strengthened the American political system. But ironically, party primaries are now seen as one of the potential culprits in this polarization problem. And the reason why that might be true is actually fairly obvious if one thinks about it. One of them is the fact that in choosing the candidates in a primary system, you have the Republicans voting in one primary and the Democrats voting in the other. And what they tend to do is to pick somebody who's the most popular among the Republicans and the most popular among the Democrats. And they're likely to be a pretty far distance from the center. And the consequence of that is you get candidates who are not necessarily ones who reflect the moderate middle, the 40 to 45% of Americans who see themselves as moderate, but those who see themselves on the other ends, the 30% on each, on the middle of the 30% of each end. And that plays a large role, at least it appears, in producing the kind of polarization of having two candidates who are fairly far apart. In the old days of the smoke-filled rooms, the professional politicians were looking for someone who could win. And that meant they looked for someone who was near the middle, on their side of the middle, but nonetheless someone who could win. And candidates, therefore, were much more moderate in their views because the theory was that one side produces a moderate candidate and the other one produces an extreme candidate, gets who's going to win. So the party elite in that situation understood the causes and the consequences. exacerbating this is the fact that participation in primary voting has gone down dramatically over the last half century. It was over 70% 50 years ago. Now it's down to about 40%. And, of course, the people who are most likely to vote in party primaries are those who are most invested in the selection, and that's likely to be the people who are more extreme than the more moderate ones. So one potential explanation for the problem is the use of primaries, which winds up producing more extreme rather than more moderate candidates, which then get chosen during the course of the election. One possible solution to that was the use of the open primary, which basically said that parties could not limit voting in their own primary only to people who were already committed members of the party. So the open primary essentially said that anyone can choose to vote in a party primary regardless of whether they had been affiliated with that party in the past. The Supreme Court held that unconstitutional. The Supreme Court held in 2000 that the parties have a First Amendment right of association that guarantees them the right to decide for themselves who are members of the party and who therefore can participate in the selection of that party's candidate, and to allow individuals who are not members of the party itself to distort the selection process is an unconstitutional violation of the party's own right of association. More recently, a few states, California, Washington, and a few others, have begun experimenting with a different form of open primary, which essentially is a nonpartisan primary. That is, in the primary, anyone can run, and the two highest vote getters, regardless of who they are, even if they're the same party or non-party, whatever, get on the ballot. And that gives moderates a much greater influence on the outcome of the primary system. And then the parties themselves can either endorse one or the other or both of those candidates, or they can use other mechanisms to put their own candidates on the ballot. But at least it assures that more moderate candidates will be on the election ballot. And the constitutionality of that system remains to be firmly established. In 2007, the court tentatively suggested that such a policy might be constitutional, but it remains to be seen whether the court ultimately will uphold that. The other issue I want very briefly to mention poses a very different role of the court than what Heather was talking about. Heather was, in terms of the gerrymandering issue, was talking about the problem of the court being arguably too passive. That is, the court allowing states to have party gerrymanders and not saying they're unconstitutional. In the campaign finance context, the objection to the role of the court is somewhat different. In the campaign finance context, the concern is that money and particularly corporate and union money is having too great an influence on the political process, creating a disillusion and alienation on the part of voters who feel that the system is completely outside their control or influence, and therefore turning them off on the democracy, and also that it has much too great an influence both in terms of corrupting candidates and office holders, and in terms of allowing the views and interests of corporations and unions to dominate the political process. And in the face of that, Congress, in bipartisan legislation signed by President George W. Bush, enacted the Bipartisan Campaign Finance Act, which limited the amount that corporations and unions could spend in political campaigns. And the Supreme Court in Citizens United 2 years ago, in a 5-4 bitterly divided decision, held that legislation unconstitutional, concluding that it violated the First Amendment to restrict the rights of corporations and unions to spend whatever they wished in the political process. And that decision puts an enormous obstacle in the way of those who believe that state of affairs is incompatible with a healthy democratic system. And the only way realistically that Citizens United could be changed would be either by constitutional amendment, which is exceedingly unlikely. Only 4 Supreme Court decisions have ever been overruled by constitutional amendment, or presumably by the fears of the Congress and the fears of the dissenters in Citizens United proving to be true. That is, one of the issues in Citizens United was the majority concluded that the reasons for these regulations were speculative, and the damage to the democratic system had not been sufficiently demonstrated and proved to justify such a severe restriction on the rights of corporations and unions. If it turns out that the members of Congress who enacted the legislation and the justices who dissented in Citizens United prove true in a world in which we now have freewheeling corporate and union unrestricted expenditures, then it's possible that a future court would be willing to reexamine the question and say that in the light of the realities that have now been demonstrated, that Citizens United could be overruled.